introduction, and then I'll be seated and kind of go through these slide pictures. The history of Bernard Mullerlau. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Mullerlau reunion. This is a nice gathering of our family. Beautiful. We have, I was asked to give this talk on the presentation of my father's immigration into the United States. And like most of the Mullerlaus who entered by way of Ellis Island, my father came in by way of Newfoundland, St. John's, Newfoundland. And what lured him there was, at the age of 25, was that he was a game master on his father's farm in the Durenbach Valley near Schutertal. And he took care of the game animals and harvesting of the meat and fur-bearing animals. And his love of the hunt actually drew him to Newfoundland. He heard there were people up there that he could make a fortune and become a rich man in the fur trade. So he had connections with somebody he was supposed to meet up with, and when he took passage on the ship over there, he found out he didn't have the person, did not materialize that he was supposed to connect up with. And so I guess he was able, a lot of this is hearsay, hearing him talk a few things about it. Bernard was pretty tight-lipped about his German immigration, not saying much about it. He never went back to the old country again after he'd left, and I'm sure that was a heartbreak for his mother and father, but well, especially to the mother, you know how mothers are with kids. But anyway, Bernard ended up in on the lure of going over and becoming a rich man in the fur trade. He got over there and found out he could not find this person he was to connect with. And so he went ahead and somehow got a hold of Wilhelm, his father in the Durenbach Valley. And Wilhelm told him to immigrate across into British Columbia, and he would get a hold of Louis Mullerlau, his brother, down in Quincy, Washington. And my father had to have $100 in his pocket and a letter of recommendation saying he was destined to go to a job in the United States. That was the rules back in 1929.
Good rules.
Yep. So anyway, he took passage. He was a whole year in Canada. And a lot of it was an old box of photographs I had that showed me a few things that maybe these were in Canada, and you'll see them on the slides. He gave up his idea that he was going to become a rich man in the fur trade, so he headed on out to immigrate then down into Washington by way of British Columbia. So we'll move on. So we'll get started at the beginning. My father was born July the 3rd, of course, of 1904. It would have been 113 years ago. Mm-hmm. And he was a home birth and the third son of Wilhelm and Cecilia Dorner Mullerlau. Their home is in the Sigmundhof in the Durenbach Valley near Schutertal. Still a working farm dating back to 1625. Wow. The home is still standing. Bernard is the second from the left, and you can click on the next picture, if you will. Here's the family. My father, of course, is the gentleman on the top, left, right there, mm-hmm. left of his sister, on the top row. Bernard is second from the left on the top row, and there were 10 in that family. Wilhelm, the father, sitting here very sternly with a mustache, married and had two children, two of the girls, by his first marriage. And his wife passed away, and he married his wife's sister and had eight or nine more children with her.
Oh wow. Wow.
And so a very large family. And you can click to the next slide. This picture was taken in front of a tool shed. I found it interesting that Wilhelm, the father, with the little bowler cap on his head, looking at his feet, almost all pictures of him, he was barefooted. And it made me wonder if he didn't have some feet problems, and he was, couldn't wear shoes, or maybe he just felt more comfortable going barefoot. But a lot of pictures, he was barefoot. My father, standing there at probably age 14, 13 or 14, folding the dog. The dresses are so beautiful back in those days, but imagine summer heat, wearing those heavy garments, you know. Okay, next slide, sir. This photograph was taken in front of the Sigmundhof farmhouse, and I had no idea what these pictures were about. I came into possession of a box of old photographs of my father's that were passed to me then when my mother passed away. And I had, unfortunately, on the backs of them was nothing written on them, our dates. And it was just, I could see my father sitting right center. Father Wilhelm, Grandfather Wilhelm on the left, and Cecilia Dorner, my grandmother, on the right. A couple of sisters there I recognize. But for the most part, I had no idea what this picture was about. When I first met up with Herman von Erlaug, he talked to me on the phone. And that was my first connection, right after we connected with you. You hooked me up with my family. And Herman called me from Shershan. And he said, is a little connection perhaps? He says, I have an uncle who goes to America in 1929, Bernard Mullerlau. I said, that is my father. Oh, my father, your father, are brothers. We must meet. Oh. And that's when we met, was at Monticello with you. Yeah. And
amazing.
It was amazing. And of course, Big Herman, he could speak a little English, but he would always apologize. Let's forgive my little English. I am self-taught. I said, your little English is a lot better than my little German, because I don't speak any German. So when Herman says, I will send you a picture, and I said, okay, I will send you a picture. And I chose this picture to send to Herman. Within a short period of time, like 3 weeks later, I get a letter back in the mail, postmarked from Germany, and it's from Herman Mullerlei from Schürzen. I open it up, and here is the picture of the picture that I sent to him. Now, what was the odds of him picking out that picture? And I thought, oh, they must have got it mixed up, and they returned it to me. And then I saw it was in somebody's handwriting, probably not Herman's, because he couldn't write or speak very good English. He had an interpreter do it for him. They had written across the top of that picture, my uncle Bernhard goes to America, his going away party.
Oh!
Isn't that just something else?
Oh, wow. My goodness.
His going away party.
And they got so dressed up for it.
Oh, yes. They were all dressed. The gentleman on the right's got a concertina.
Yes.
An accordion.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. The old home still stands like that. When I went over in 98, the big old stone steps leading up into the home are all curved out from the many German boots going up and down that, and I have a picture of myself sitting on those same steps after 61 years.
Wow.
You know, Father kind of kept it quiet. He never said much about it. He came over right as Hitler was coming into power, and, you know, things were kind of tense.
Yes.
And anyway, we can move on. Next picture. This is Wilhelm Mullerlei, brother to Louis Mullerlei of Quincy, Washington. The two men favor each other an awfully lot. And he was called the Kaiser. Yeah, he was. He lived in the valley there, and all the Germans said he was my way or no way. And when my father immigrated to America, I understand that he and the older brothers left because Wilhelm, the boys wanted to bring electric power down to the home. They had no power there. And the old man, he wanted to have a turbine put in the creek. Well, the Dürrenberg Creek dried up in the summertime. And so why would they go with all this, put that in the creek? And the old Wilhelm, no, that electricity's over on that mountain over there, and that comes here. We get it free out of the creek. And so the three older boys split off. My father went to America, and the other two boys, one went to Lahr, to a leather factory, I understand. And trying to trace down where all these they got off to. So we'll move on. Next slide. And this is the ship that I assume that my father came across to Newfoundland, his passport on the right, and the Canadian Pacific, the Minnedosa. My father said he came over steerage, maybe think of the Titanic, the poor people traveled under in steerage. And so he came across. He never mentioned it to me ever in all the years of, you know, the 61 years that I was, away from the family. And I wish later I was age 30 when Father died, that I could have picked his brain a little bit more and had a little more information about where he had come from. He never mentioned ever getting seasick, so I guess he must have been a pretty good sailor. Okay, next slide. Passport to Newfoundland. as he got stuck in St. John's, Newfoundland, and Wilhelm, the father over there, said, take passage on a train, some way get out to British Columbia. He hooked up on a train, and I'm sure this is probably the train he went out to British Columbia on. Basically, the whole boxcars were loaded up with Polish people. And if you notice, there's stove stacks sticking up out of the boxcars. The train would stop periodically on the way, and the men, young men would get out, and they'd gather firewood. And the Polish woman, she would serve up a big bowl of hash brown stew, whatever she had available. And they would commonly eat out of that, and it heated the boxcar as well as served to cook their food. And so you can move on, Sam. Here he is as a young immigrant. He looks kind of lost. I'm here in British Columbia. I'm here in Newfoundland. Where do I go? Okay, go ahead, honey. And a little area here, there's a little bedroom along the way. I assume these were all taken in Canada. Found it interesting, the boar's tusk in that little arrangement that he's got sitting on his desk right there. I think he found those boar tusks somewhere. He was always prowling around in the woods. On the left of that was a picture of his father. I'm almost certain that it was Wilhelm and not Louis Maurel. And, okay, and the next one. He looks like he's pretty well lost there. He has a pair of Lederhosen on. And I never knew my father must have ditched those along the way because I never remembered him ever having a pair of Lederhosen. He's laying there thinking, now here I am on my way out to British Columbia. Maybe this was in British Columbia, it's hard to say. He was a whole year up there before he got passage down to work for Louis. Okay, go ahead, honey. Must have picked up a little work at a hog farm. I had this picture in the box of all these pigs. Father never mentioned anything about working at a hog farm, but there he is standing there. I imagine he picked up a little work every here and there he could get it, you know, to sustain himself until he could immigrate then down into America. Go ahead. A logging crew. Wow. Interesting. Did he really actually work for a logging crew? And that's my father Bernard on the left-hand side bottom there with the axe. Mm-hmm. Yep. And the old boy out there in the little white nightshirt with his arm and got a bandage on it, he must have been... had an accident out in the woods. Uh-huh. He came up with a photo. Yeah, and a photo too. Get your butt out here. We need you on the picture. Okay, next one. Then. And this one, of course, is Uncle Louis Quincy Washington. Very handsome man. He immigrated probably 6 or 7 years ahead of my father. Had already had gotten established himself at Quincy and had started to deal in some real estate. Selling fruit trees and starting his own watermelon gardens. And so he probably was thrilled to get my father to come down from Canada and be a working man for his little farm there, Quincy. Except that Uncle Louis had the same thing, my way or no way. So poor old Bernie, he just went from one father that he had troubles with and moved in with the brother, the uncle, and the same situation. Here they are with a load of watermelons. My father on the right, of course. That's Uncle Louis on the left. And they were in Wenatchee, Washington, selling watermelons down there. My father drove that old truck with a load of watermelons from Quincy all the way into Wenatchee down a steep, steep grade of mountain road. And I'm sure he didn't have a driver's license and he probably didn't even know how to drive very good because all of the people in Quincy called him the Flying Dutchman. And when they'd see the old boy coming down the hill with a load of watermelons, everybody got out of his way, boy. I wonder he didn't tip that whole load of melons over. Okay, go ahead. And he picked up enough money and got enough things scraped together to buy himself his first car, a little 29 Chevrolet car. Okay, and we'll move to the next one. After he left the employment, I guess he didn't get along too well with his Uncle Louis, and he finally left employment with Louis and was offered a job out at the Columbia and Okanagan's Nurseries in Wenatchee, Washington, and they were basically a company that raised fruit trees, small fruit trees, apples, pears. And so they put him up in a little tit cabin right there, and they gave him the job of chief irrigator on the CNO nursery spread. They call it CNO nursery. I was born on the old CNO nursery. Anybody familiar with Washington know where Rocky Reach Dam stands? That was where I was born, on the Douglas County side, right where that hydro dam is in right there now. And at that time, it was a fruit tree. Basically, they had a pump house down on the Columbia River, and they pumped the water up to irrigate all the young apple trees. Father lived in the little tent cabin. This is before he married my mother. Okay. Then that photo of that one that we just watched was probably around 1932 or 33. Bernard found the love of his life, my mother Ida. And from there, love sprang, and then Father moved on to CNO nursery work. And then my mother was going to school in Quincy, Washington. She had lost her mother, and she moved down with an older brother there to further her education, and that's where she met my father. And so Father talked her into coming out to CNO, and they ended up getting married. And I was with my brother, and I were born out there, the old CNO nursery. Mm-hmm. Okay, you can move on. And Bernard, this was taken in 61, just prior to him passing away. In fact, that was, I think that picture was taken at Don's and my wedding. And trying to get him into a suit was another story. Because if there was hunting and fishing and trapping to do, that old boy was out in the mountains. And anyway, when he would get done at the work day, working the CNO nursery and the irrigating, he would set out his trap lines, and he'd go up each evening after work, and he'd check his traps. So he's going along up there one evening with his traps. He always carried a .22 rifle to dispatch any animal that was in the trap, and they had at that time, you know, in 1932, a bounty as well as money for the fur. You could make, you know, through the winter, Father didn't have irrigation work there with the CNO, so he pretty well fed the family by selling bobcat and coyote pelt. And so one evening he puts his rifle in his hands, and he goes up to check his trap lines. Go ahead, honey. And he comes face to face with this. Oh. And in Germany, and I don't know if this is true, is there no skunks, American skunks in Germany?
No, only in the zoo.
Only in the zoo. Yeah. And so my father's coming down the trail, and here's this cute little black and white kitten going down the trail. And in his mind, he thinks, this is going to be a wonderful gift for Ida.
Oh.
This will be a wonderful gift for Ida. So he lays his little rifle aside, and he goes, kitty, 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 kitty. And the thing didn't seem very afraid of him. It just kind of went down the trail. And Father gets around the other side, and he said, my gosh, that crazy little thing. Turned around, and up came that tail, and he said, he baptized me right then and there. I got baptized in Germany as a Catholic, and dying if I didn't get baptized by a skunk out at the CNO nursery. So he, gagging and spitting, he grabs his rifle and he heads on back down to the river, to the pump house, finds an old piece of baling wire, and he had just bought a brand new set of work clothes, Dickie shirt and pants, and you know, he was pinching his pennies, so that had to have been a pretty good amount of money to buy new work clothes. He had those on that evening when the skunk got him.
Aww.
So he took those clothes off down to his buff and tied them on that wire and sunk them in the Columbia River on a big rock. And he tiptoed back to his little tent cabin and nothing but a smile on his face and boots on his feet. So he drew him a bath. He first got in the river and he washed and washed, and then he got up to his tent cabin and he dug a couple of more hot baths and scrubbed and scrubbed, and finally got to the point where it was halfway breathable.
I love this story.
And in the night, he's laying there and he hears this thump and a bump and a little scratch, scratch, scratch out there on the wood deck of his little tent cabin, and he grabs his flashlight and pulls the tent back and looks down, and there's two full-grown skunks out there loving up to his boots.
I love this story.
He promptly zips up the tent. No more to do with the skunk. So that was Bernard's kitty.
I love it.
End of talk. Thank you, Bernard.
Lovely.